Really wish you were here.
Well, good morning, Liberty. It's good to see you all again. Actually, I see a little team here, but I could close my eyes and see just about everybody sitting out there. Wake up, put that phone down, same one, sir. Good to see you, and really in the spirit. Welcome again, this is our second time. Things don't look real good at getting back in here anytime soon. So we make a few announcements. First of all, 2 weeks till our mission offering for Annie Armstrong. Okay. Almost made it. Annie Armstrong, so be praying about what you want to give. We'll find some way to do that. Also, we're trying to find some ways to do something a little more unique on Easter Day itself. So help us there by praying about that. The offerings, as mentioned on the screen, we need to make sure we get our offerings in. We still have bills to pay, so if you would, Sally's the one to get in contact with. She'll help you out in that regard. And anything else that comes along, we'll try to post it on Facebook. So keep up with us on there. And we're glad to hear that several of you have taken the plunge. You've actually got on and watched on Facebook. And those also available on YouTube. But join us. So many other churches are on there. You can find a lot of good entertainment. Stay off that TV a little bit. Get on the computer. Anything else that our ladies and gentlemen out here might have? Have I forgotten something? Okay. Then we're good to go. Let's have a word of prayer. Is that right? Is it time? I'm not looking at it. David's going to read. David, come on.
This morning I'm reading from Psalms 4. Answer me when I call, God who vindicates me. You freed me from affliction. Be gracious to me and hear my prayer. How long, exalted men, will my honor be insulted? How long will you love what is worthless and pursue a lie? Know that the Lord has set apart the faithful for himself. The Lord will hear when I call to him. Be angry and do not sin. On your bed, reflect in your heart and be still. Offer sacrifices in righteousness and trust in the Lord. Many are saying, who can show us anything good? Look on us with favor, Lord. You have put more joy in my heart than they have with their grain and their new wine abound. I will both lie down and sleep in peace, for you alone, Lord, make me live in safety.
All right, guys, good morning. Good to see you again. And we're going to start off our praise and worship singing this morning by singing Heaven Came Down. So if you would please stand, sing along with me.
Wonderful day.
tonight, and we're going to move into Eye of the Storm. This is Logan Kelly's request always. Every Sunday he asks if we can sing this one. So, Logan, I want to hear you singing loud.
In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. And in the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When my hopes and dreams are far from me and I'm running out of faith, I see the future I picture slowly fade away. When the tears of pain and heartache are falling down my face, I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. And in the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor. My sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. And in the middle of the war, you guard my soul. You alone are the anchor. When my sails are torn, your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm.
Amen. Amen.
It's time for prayer, and go ahead and do something to just kind of get you aware of that. We removed all of the names from the list of the post. We weren't sure how that would play out, but you still need, if you have a need to pray, call us. We have a Tuesday morning prayer meeting that meets. Be glad to lift you up there. We'll pray for you now. The prayer is important, maybe more so at this time than any other time. But maybe you're feeling kind of alone, and nobody cares. Well, God cares. And God hears. And God answers. So as we pray, just remember, there are plenty of those out there here going through the same thing you're going through. It's new. It's not something that we want to do. Seems like it's necessary, so we do it. The thing is, God can operate in all ways. He makes something good out of something bad. So let's pray. Our Father, thank you again for just time to stop a few moments of worship. And the Lord, it's different. It's not what we're accustomed to. It's something, Father, we hope that we don't see. It's here and your people. Just as I have down through the ages, find ways to lift you up, to praise you, lift your name, Father, in ways that show that you're our Savior and our Lord. Yes, God, now as we come to a time when we remember those who are not here, those who are maybe going through suffering, certainly the anguish and the anxiety that's coming along with this virus that's set in the world. So we pray for them, that they're doing what they need to be doing, do what they're told, in order, Lord, to slow this terrible thing down, but most of all, that gives opportunity for people to find the cures and find ways to help get around it. All these people have been blessed, but you give us so much wisdom in the medical field. We believe, Father, you're going to help them there. Ask you now, Father, as we think about all those who are struggling and suffering, those, Father, who are maybe in physical pain, we pray for them. Those who are at this time is a spiritual crisis in their lives, not sure where to look or where to turn to, we pray, Father, they find that answer in you. Once again, we know all the needs that are out there. You know, Lord, that some are great, some are small. But you're a great God and a gracious God, a powerful God. You can have all that comes into our lives. There are those who are making those decisions, once again, that will affect us as both as Americans and as Christians. We pray for leadership, and that during this critical time, they will look to you and we'll be praying. We'll be supporting them, Father, as they do those things that need to be done to get rid of this problem in our lives. Turn us, Father, once again to a path of promise. Take charge of our day. Again, Father, just pray that you might bless us. For all those who may see this, and Father, we give you the praise and glory for all. We ask in Christ's name. Rest before his son. Amen.
Our final song that we're going to sing together is not one that we as a congregation have sung before, but the choir has sung it several times. And this week, when I was just listening to music and I heard it, I was like, oh, this is perfect for the situation that we're living in, perfect for us to sing. So join us as we're going to sing Tremble.
Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. We had a little glitch. We're going to get over it. Philippians 3:10 is Paul has just got through the prior verses talking about the fact that he had a lot to be proud of. Something he didn't have. Something was his goal. His goal was, verse 10, Philippians 3:10. My goal is to know him, the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. Now, Easter is, of course, my favorite time of the year. I love most of the rest of them, but Easter is the absolute most favorite time. And also, I noticed that Easter, just reading some of the things I found lately, has taken a little bit of a beating. From the name itself to this date on the calendar, and the fact there's a biblical lack of command to even observe it, Easter is being assailed from both the left and the right. What was traditionally seen to be a Christian observance, and certainly our holy day, is facing opposition, and that kind of stands me. I have been preaching Easter messages, usually a series of messages, on Easter, about Easter, before Easter, for almost 30 years. I never get tired of reliving the old, old story of Jesus and his love. And many devout Christians object to the name Easter and believe it to be named after a pagan goddess. Much like Halloween, many don't like the name because it did not originate in the Bible. The date, which is different from year to year, has been criticized. Reference is made to the Jewish Passover, which is always held on the same day as year. Then there's the fact that we are nowhere in the Bible told to keep the day of Jesus' death or resurrection. So why do we observe this event we call Easter? Why do we do it? When we do it? How we do it? Just what is the premise behind our celebration of the greatest event in the history of the world? So folks, actually, we celebrate the two events that changed the world for good, the crucifixion and the resurrection. This is often called the cross-resurrection event, and thus, many Christians refuse to call Easter Sunday Easter and prefer the term Resurrection Sunday. I don't have any problems with those who see some inherent evil in the name Easter, though my studies about this point otherwise. I don't have any problems with bunnies and eggs, as long as they're not doctrinally attached to Easter. And we don't seem to have a whole lot of problem with Santa and Christmas because we can keep them separate. And we're only 2 weeks out from Easter, and this is the first of three messages we'll bring folks in on Easter. Now, folks, because the Holy Day is under attack from seemingly without end within, it will be today's emphasis to review why we have Easter or the premise behind Easter. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and then Easter. As much as I hate it, it looks like we'll still be quarantined during that time frame. We'll miss much of what the Easter season would normally bring to us. But we're celebrating this wonderful time of the year. We're going to celebrate with you on Facebook. And we're going to try to bring something a little bit different in order to do that. But that's 2 weeks down the road, so be praying for us in that regard. So first of all, understanding why, the premise of why we have Easter, you can look at the Old Testament roots. See, much of what we believe and much of what we hold as true in our faith has its beginnings in the Old Testament. And the Old Testament is primarily the story of God's dealings with Israel and the Jews as his chosen people. It points to a time when the mantle is passed to the church as the new people of God. And much of how God deals with his people has changed from the Old Testament to the New Testament, including the observance of special days. So to understand the premise or the why of Easter, let's go back and look so we can understand the Passover. Look with me to Exodus chapter 12. Exodus 12, where the Passover is given. A few verses beginning in verse 21. Exodus 12, verse 21. It says, Moses summoned all the elders of Israel. He said to them, go select an animal from the flock according to your families and slaughter the Passover lamb. Take a cluster of hyssop, dip it in the blood that is in the basin and brush the lintel and the two doorposts with some of the blood in the basin. None of you may go out of the door of his house until morning. That sounds kind of like what we're going to do. Right. When the Lord passes through to strike Egypt and sees the blood on the lintel and the two doorposts, he will pass over the door and not let the destroyer enter your house to strike you. So keep this command perfectly as a statute for you and your descendants. When you enter the land that the Lord will give you as he promised, you are to observe this ritual. When your children ask you, what does this ritual mean to you? You are to reply, it is the Passover sacrifice to the Lord. For he passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians and spared our homes. So the people bowed down and worshiped. And the Israelites went and did this. They did just as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. Now the prior verses, if you go back before this in Exodus, it reveals God's command to Moses about the Passover. And we find a little more about the why, the when, and the who. The Passover was given to the slaves coming out of Egypt now on their way to the promised land. Thus it was given to the Jews to do in remembrance of God saving them from that 10th plague of Egypt, which is called the death of the firstborn. But all the firstborn of Egypt, from the Pharaoh down to the servant and the livestock, were killed because Pharaoh would not let God's people go. As the death angel saw the blood on the Israelite sacrifice on the level of the door, he passed over them.
Right.
Now, what was struck me, and I've never read this before, this was so miraculous that even the dogs did not stir or bark while this was going on. Well, I don't have the time to go through all the reasons why we must be careful in how we interpret the Old Testament and apply it to us today. What God is commemorating in the Passover is simply another of the ways in which he meets our needs on a daily basis.
Right, amen.
And because it's just human nature to forget, to neglect, or minimize what God has done for us, the Israelites are told to observe the Passover on the 14th of Nisan throughout all their generations. So this is always celebrated on that day on the Jewish calendar. And it does change when it converts over to our calendar. But this year, Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread that followed it occurs between April the 8th and April 16th. We believe this Passover meal, or the Seder meal, is the one that Jesus is having with his disciples, and we know it now as the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper. It was important to Jesus, as the perfect Jew, to observe the Passover. He was supposed to. It was commanded. It was, and it still is, a Jewish holy day. That's not ours. Pick up verse 29, Exodus 12. At midnight, the Lord struck every firstborn male in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh, who sat on his throne, the firstborn of the prisoners who was in the dungeon, and every firstborn of the livestock. During the night, Pharaoh got up, he along with all his officials and all the Egyptians, and there was a loud wailing throughout Egypt, because there wasn't a house without someone dead. He summoned Moses and Aaron during the night and said, "Get up, leave my people, both you and the Israelites, and go worship the Lord as you have been asked. Take even your flocks and your herds as you asked and leave, and this will also be a blessing to me."
Right.
So remember now, the children of Israel, or Jacob's 12 sons, had migrated to Egypt 400 years earlier to escape famine in their land. You'll find this in Genesis 47. Over time, they became mere slaves to the Egyptians, and because they multiplied so fast, they were seen as a threat to Pharaoh. To keep them under control, he greatly multiplied their servitude until they were crying out for deliverance. We now know that God then called an 80-year-old Moses to confront Pharaoh and to deliver his people from bondage. Exodus 3 is the story of Moses' call. Now, giving no heed to the excuses of Moses, God used him to defeat Pharaoh, lead those Israelites out of Egypt on the way to the land promised to Abraham, their ancestor, many, many years earlier. Now, it was no easy task to get Pharaoh to release these slaves, or essentially they were working for free.
Right.
And through the 10 plagues that God brought on Egypt, he showed his power both to the Egyptians and to the people he had chosen for his own. Now remember, after 400 years with no priests or religious leaders to teach them, God had to reintroduce himself to his people. Right. Now Moses was right in asking for the name of the God who was sending him to deliver Israel. And this God, the I Am, overcame the bondage of Egypt and the Egyptians, and they even paid them to go. You know, God does things like that. Mm-hmm. Then and now.
Amen.
Now, I've got one here that's not in the scriptures, and there's a reason for it. To the Passover, an expectation has been added. Now, most people agree it was around the 15th or 16th centuries that a new phrase was added to the Passover celebration. Now, without biblical command, at the end of the Seder or the Passover meal, all would say, "Next year in Jerusalem." And yes, God had delivered them from Egypt and from their bondage to Pharaoh, but they now looked for the Messiah to come and make Israel great again. The Messiah became a type of rallying figure for Israel who had suffered at the hands of several countries because of their idolatry and their disobedience to God. They had been dispersed throughout the world, and they longed to come back to their promised land. Now, in very specific ways in which God told the Jews to celebrate the Passover, he did not mention Jerusalem or the Messiah. Yet the hope of a rebuilt and reunified Israel under the Messiah manifested itself in their greatest holy day, Passover. We know they have completely screwed up the concept of the Messiah, but for years, the longing for his coming was added to that Passover celebration. And the Jews of today, unfortunately, still look for and expect the Messiah to come soon. How tragic that they missed him, but he did come. So the Passover commemorates the deliverance of God's first people from bondage and slavery. The addition of the expectation of the Messiah should have prepared the faithful Jews for what he came, when he came to them in the person of Jesus Christ. The groundwork is now laid for our Easter, and Jesus takes the Passover and makes it happen. So there's the roots now in the Old Testament, but there's the New Testament that gives us the sanction to celebrate. We do love and should love the Old Testament. It's God's words to his people. But we must be careful when using the Old Testament in New Testament times. Understand the centerpiece of the Old Testament was the law, and Jesus fulfilled the law in every jot and tittle.
Right.
And we live in an age of grace. We're no longer bound by the law. Now, this upsets some folks when I say this, but they cannot grasp, but I'm actually referring to the everyday living out of our lives. And folks, God includes, or should include, obeying the law to the best of our abilities. But it is not necessary for salvation.
Right.
But the Old Testament, folks, understand, has 613 laws. Many of them were altered by Jesus by one simple phrase. You have heard it said, but I say. Most of this is found in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5. But Jesus, you see, looked beyond the letter of the law to the spirit of the law.
Right.
This is what gives us the okay to celebrate Easter today. First of all, John 1:41. John 1:41. This is the story of Jesus calling Andrew and Simon, his apostles and disciples, and following him. And look at verse 40 first of all. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard John and followed him. He first found his own brother Simon and told him, "We have found the Messiah," which means the anointed one. Brings him to Jesus. See, Andrew's excited words to Peter is the first recorded declaration of Jesus as the Messiah or the Christ. However, many Old Testament prophecies pointed directly to Jesus, to his ministry, and to his death. Messiah simply means anointed or chosen one, and in a very distinct way points back to God and his choosing of Israel as his people. Over the history of Israel, we find a pattern of idolatry and disobedience, which brought God's punishment on them. But over and over, God would then send a deliverer to lead them back to him. Prophets, priests, and kings had tried for centuries to keep Israel focused on him, but their sin had led God to remove his blessings. At the time of Jesus' arrival in the first century, God had been silent as Israel suffered under the hands of foreign oppressors. The Jews wanted the Messiah to appear and deliver them, and he came. But he did not come as they imagined. He came as an ordinary man, not as some mythical Superman. He came on a donkey meant for service, not on a white charger meant for a conquering king. He came to die for lost mankind, not to restore a nation to prominence. So why is this important, you may ask? Well, folks, it is the Messiah who is the direct link from the Jewish Old Testament to our Christian New Testament. Jesus, our Savior, look at John chapter 4. John 4, 25 and 26. Jesus speaks to the woman at the well, and the woman said to him, verse 25, "I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." And in verse 26, "I am he," Jesus told her, "the one speaking to you." The Messiah has come. But also, in reference to the Passover, you need to understand that Jesus is our Passover. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. Paul says, "Clean out the old yeast, so that you may be a new batch, since you are unleavened. For Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed." Again, if you read this section that Paul is writing to the Corinthian church, he tells them to abstain from the acts of immorality, and he references the Passover routine of removing all the leaven from the house for that 7-day feast of unleavened bread. The leaven was a symbol of sin. to remove it from the home symbolized them removing sin from their lives. The sacrifice of the Passover lamb was to symbolize the individual's repentance from sin. As that innocent lamb bled and died, the sins of the individual were forgiven and removed. Paul declared Jesus to be our Passover sacrifice, the sinless Lamb of God given for our sins. Now, we don't celebrate a great military victory or deliverance from the most powerful nation on earth as the Passover commemorates, but we've been delivered from the far more terrifying bondage of the sins that separate us from our holy God. Our sin debt had to be paid, and the killing of a lamb was not enough to satisfy God's righteousness. Now, what had become merely an annual spectacle of the death of thousands of sheep, the clean clanging of the money changers in the temple, and the crowds of people who were only doing what habit dictated, was now going to be done away with in the one-time offering of Jesus for the sins of all mankind. Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews 9, 3 verses 24 through 28. For the Messiah did not enter a sanctuary made with hands, only a model of the true one, but into heaven itself, that he might now appear in the presence of God for us. He did not do this to offer himself many times, as the high priest entered the sanctuary yearly with the blood of another. Otherwise, he would have had to suffer many times since the foundation of the world. But now he has appeared one time at the end of the ages for the removal of sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for people to die once, and after this judgment, so also the Messiah, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. Mm-hmm. Now, understand, contrary to a prevailing view that is kind of sneaking its way into the Baptist circles today, Jesus did not just die for a select few. Right. No. He died once, he died for all. Amen. As the years moved along, and after the destruction of the temple, the church eventually left off the celebration of the Passover for the great truth that was finally taking hold. Jesus is our Passover.
Right. Amen.
Mark chapter 16. Mark 16, 1 through 5. Because Easter is now done. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so they could go and anoint him. Very early in the morning, on the first day of the week, they went to the tomb at sunrise. They were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone from the entrance to the tomb for us?" So looking up, they observed that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. When they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a long white robe sitting on the right side, and they were amazed and alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he told them. "You're looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has been resurrected. He is not here."
Amen.
Oh, that glorious morning when Jesus' tomb was found empty. The one who had been rejected as the Messiah and had died as a sinless sacrifice for the sins of sinful man had risen from the grave. The Messiah did not come to deliver Israel from a dictator. He came to fulfill the law which man could not keep, and in his final appearance with his disciples, he changed the Passover from the celebration of a physical appearance of God's people from Egypt for slavery to a memorial of his impending sacrifice and death for all mankind. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians 11. Verses 25 through 26. Paul says, "In the same way, he also took the cup after supper and said, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Our Easter celebration reminds us not of physical deliverance, but a spiritual one that the blood of bulls, goats, and sheep could never affect. No, we don't observe the Passover, for we're not Jewish. We do observe the victory of Jesus over sin, death, hell, and the grave, which was first revealed on that Sunday morning when a few of Jesus' disciples were changed by his resurrection. Now again, the early church did observe both the Passover, and then they would gather for worship on the first day of the week until the temple was destroyed. But the place of sacrifices under the law gone, they then met to celebrate Jesus' victory over death on the day they found the tomb empty. Now, even the church resisted any annual celebration of any kind for many years, but the magnitude of Jesus' resurrection begged to be celebrated, and Easter was born. But do we need to apologize for Easter? No. See, we worship a risen, resurrected Savior and Lord. He deserves all the praise from a day and a season set aside for him. In our Easter observance, we worship no idols, no man, and no things. We simply relive the acts that brought to us salvation for all time, brought to us our power to live today, and brought to us our hope for the future. Again, the Bible tells us many things that we should do as the people of God. We're encouraged to live our daily lives in a manner that glorifies the one who lives within us.
Amen.
We have surely found out that we can't do that in our meager power alone.
Right.
We need a power that transcends the flesh. No amount of push-ups, sit-ups, or cleaning jerks can make us strong enough to withstand the onslaught of our great enemy Satan, the demands of our flesh, and the allure of the world. Paul knew that, and Paul prayed for that power to do that. He found it in our text, Philippians 3:10. In the resurrection.
Amen.
The resurrection power would be a good song.
That's a good one.
If we had no other reason to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, the access to the same power in our lives that raised Jesus from the dead would be sufficient. As a child, I loved comic books, and one of the advertisements in nearly all those comic books would be a picture of a guy, a skinny guy. At the time, I was kind of skinny. And he's getting sand kicked in his face by this older, bigger guy and a bully up there. And in a way, that's a picture of what we are today. We're that powerless guy, and Satan is the big one. Easter reminds us that he was defeated by Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection from the grave.
Right, yeah.
And we should see every Sunday as a type of mini Easter.
Yes.
It's no wonder that it was inevitable the church would have to set aside a day to glory in the cross and the resurrection event. Right. It is only proper that we walk with Jesus on the last week of his life on earth, Holy Week. We must never forget how Jesus suffered at the hands of sinful man, how he died for our sins. We must continue to rejoice in that new life that is now ours, because Jesus was raised from the dead on the third day, which happened to be the first day of the week.
Right.
That is our premise for Easter. That settles it for me. Again, we can't not celebrate Easter, and I realize that's a double day. It just heightens and intensifies it. We have to have Easter. Mm-hmm. The premise is we can't do without.
Right.
Sheila's going to now play something softly. We're going to bow our heads and have a little time of invitation. So where you are out there in the internet world, bow your heads for a few moments. Let's talk to the Lord. He may be talking to you. The Holy Spirit always deals with us during this particular time, so we ask you to open your heart up to him. Just like we'd be here when he speaks to you, listen. Be honest about what he's saying to you, and disobey. We know that Easter's coming for a particular reason. If we had not sinned, it would not happen. It would not happen. We would never do it. But folks, we did sin, we do sin. And Jesus is our answer. He is our Passover lamb. He is the one sacrificed one time for all people, for you and me. If you have not made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, what a glorious time. You'll never forget this particular Easter 2020, if you give your heart and life to him then. It's only a matter of faith, distrusting, and believing what Easter's all about. The gospel, the good news, Jesus died, was buried, was resurrected for us. We know there are things that day by day trouble us. This is a very troubling time, a difficult time. Just ask you now to understand that there's a power available. Paul understood it. Power of the resurrection. The power that changed our world forever is available to us every day. Claim it. Use it for God's glory. Thank you once again for what you do for us, Lord. We ask you now. Dismiss us to your grace and your love. Yes, he's singing that in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Don't forget, we'll be back again Wednesday night for a Bible study. We'll see a few things on the Facebook page, so keep checking in for things that will follow from this. And pray for us again as we try to do something that will make Easter meaningful and worshipful for us in 2020. God bless. We're out.
We pray.